And I'm really glad to be able to introduce this morning my friend Joel Fillol, who you probably all know. He's a coach of elite level triathletes. The triathletes he coaches achieved 15 podium finishes in the World Triathlon Series just this season. And the group includes men like Mario Mola or Richard Murray, and women like Katie Safares and I can never remember her first name, Clamert. So without further delay, please welcome Joel Fillol, who is going to talk about consistency in triathlon performance over three Olympic Games.
Thanks first for the invitation. I find this stuff really valuable as a coach to go through, particularly this project that I was given here. It was a suggestion, and it's a great one for me to revisit a great career of a great Olympian, Simon Whitfield, who I had the privilege to coach for some of that time. I'm going to go through the history of all of his time, but consistency over four Olympic Games. I changed the title, although he's one of the few athletes. Simon is one of the few athletes to actually achieve the starts at all four Olympic Games in triathlon, which is pretty special. It's a very small list, so I changed that. Although his big performances, of course, came through three. So really, what I wanted to pull out was the key points over the whole career. So I'm not going to talk so much about how you're consistent in one season. I think there was some of that stuff yesterday. But really some of the key points that I thought that were important both for Simon, but equally that I could take away for other athletes and learn from, because I think that's one of the key things for Simon. So to start, I've got a video to kind of wake everyone up and remind people what Simon has achieved. The quality is not great. There's some text which I will explain, but I think you'll get the gist of it. Although my video appears to be gone. Maybe I won't do the video now. Save it for the end then. All right. I will continue. First of all, I think it's important to acknowledge the people that contributed to this. Simon's other coaches, but obviously Simon. So when I was approached with this topic, I thought, well, I should get Simon's opinion. What does he think? And I had a whole list of questions for Simon. We had a conversation. Of course, I couldn't answer any of the questions. We talked for several hours, I'm actually going to chop that up and put that on my website if people want to actually listen to the conversation we had, because I think it was really good, retrospective from the athlete himself. But I think it's important for me to acknowledge the impact that the work that I did with him had on my career. It was massively influential on the learning, the process, going through both from, was actually Simon's training partner roughly when as we were juniors and developed until I was his coach from 05 to 08. So first from Simon, of course, everyone probably knows who Barry Shepley is, ITU announcer. He's been a builder in Canada for ever since Triathlon Canada was operated out of someone's basement in, I don't know where it was, in Vancouver or Toronto. Really since the very beginnings, and Barry has been there all along. He was the coach for Sydney, where Simon won gold. So Barry contributed a lot of his feedback, and of course Lance Watson, the gold medal coach from Sydney, had some very valuable feedback. I fit in the gap there between after Athens through to Beijing. And then Paulo Souza was in 10, and then John Brown is currently with New Zealand. All these guys contributed, so thanks to them. There's the video. Nope. We'll watch the video. It's about 5 minutes long.
I've been relentless. I think that's been my key, is I'm obsessed and I'm relentless.
Simon's making his move. He's trying to reel him in. It's getting closer.
They are going to run under the steps of the Opera House, and Simon Whitfield seems to be gaining ground with every stride. Simon Whitfield is sprinting towards the finish line, trying to haul in Vukovic. Simon Whitfield is coming at him. Simon Whitfield is going to
do it.
Simon Whitfield has moved into the lead. Simon Whitfield racing to the finish line. This 25-year-old from Kingston, Ontario, so relaxed and composed this morning. He was signing autographs, laughing and talking to the spectators, and he is going to win the gold medal. Canada, Simon Whitfield, gold. Vukovic is going to finish in second place, and Simon Whitfield has provided Canada with its first gold medal.
For any Canadians in the room, I love that point that the second commentator is called Paul Regensburg, and he was heavily involved in Simon's development in the National Training Center in Victoria, and they had to cut off his mic because he couldn't control himself. So, but obviously some great races there. I mean, those are some of the classics, and you see in Beijing how he was off the back and how he fought back in and then made that acceleration, that move. So a couple of the comments that he made, I'm going to go into these, but it's kind of a Simon expression, this relentlessly obsessed, and what that means. So I'll talk a little bit about that commitment to the process. And for Simon, the journey between those four Olympic Games was very different, and I think there's some key points that certainly he and I talked about in reflection that maybe made the results different and something to be learned there. And then I think the third key point just from that video is just the newfound joy that he had coming from trying to defend in Athens, which he wasn't able to do, to having such a great race in Beijing. So just briefly, when I told Simon about this talk, and he's like, oh, was I consistent? I don't know, maybe he doubted it for a second, but clearly he was. This is the graph of the ITU results through his career. It's not all of his performances. But from 1995, junior in Cancun, all the way to London Olympics. So you can see from just before Sydney through to certainly to 2009-10, there's a lot of the numbers right around that line. That's a lot of podium performances. So, and then just briefly highlighting what that was. I mean, I think there's only two double medalists. Maybe after Rio, there'll be some more double Olympic medalists. But right now, Simon and Bevan Docherty. Manchester Commonwealth gold was a big goal of his. I think I counted 16 World Cup podiums, so of course that's what World Series are now. And then in a span of 10 years, top eight at the World Championships four times. And then we talked about Athens 11th and Beijing. And then finally, although he didn't have the race he wanted in London, he crashed on the bike, but to achieve four Olympic Games is pretty special. So the success factors that we pulled out, that I pulled out, they're the big rocks. They're the big things that we thought about. And I put these in order that I thought they were the most important to Simon. And I'm going to go into each of these. This is kind of the summary. So the psychology, who he was as an athlete, and what traits made him consistent over that extraordinary long career. The environment around him, and the environment that he created around him, and how he was able to do that, I think is unique. It's rare. There's something to be learned there. And finally, a little bit on preparation. After Sergio's talk yesterday, I went back and looked through some training plans, and I think there's something interesting there, and certainly something that came out of our talks when we reflected back on the training that we did. So first of all, psychology and competition. The first point may be a given, but I think he thinks of himself, and I think his record shows he's a big event racer. Meaning he really gets up for big events, Olympic Games, World Championships. And I say that because that's not the case for everybody. I'm sure we can all think of. I have some athletes that competition is scary. They have fear about it. Others that are sort of in the middle. Obviously, they love to race. That's what we're doing. We're preparing to compete with the best. But they're perhaps not the type of athletes that get energy from these kind of goals, that grow from those goals. And Simon was definitely that guy. It drove him through his career. And I think it's important to recognize, because we've got athletes along that continuum. But to have a long career, I think you've got to love to race. You've got to get out there and put the energy on the day and find that motivation. So the confidence and ego, I mean, I think this is, we all talk about confidence, don't we? But the belief to win, you put yourself in the right place. And I mean, we saw there's partly a reason why, because he had extraordinary finishing speed. I think with all the athletes I've worked with, I've never come across anyone that had as much raw, might call easy speed as Simon. But he had to put himself in place to win. And I think that was something that maybe changed later in his career. Through to London, he started to lose a little bit of that, and he talked about that in our discussion. But certainly, in order to be consistent over a long career, you've got to have that innate belief in yourself. You've got to be willing to put yourself in the right place. And again, we you know, when I think of athletes I work with now or observe, there's sometimes a reluctance to do that. You know they maybe have the skills to win or to podium or to be successful, but they don't always pull the trigger when the opportunity is there. So I think that was a real key point. Simon had extraordinary race intelligence, the ability to read races and to know what to do, tactical awareness. And I'm going to talk about this, I think, in the next point as well. But you know, that comes from studying the sport. And when we were talking about this and certainly reflecting on it, I remember even from training, he described the race sort of slows down for him. So many athletes are like a deer caught in headlights in races. They don't see anything. But Simon could see everything around him. He always knew right where he was in the swim. He could look around and know who was around him and know what to do, know what position to be in. And I think that's an extremely important trait when you're talking about learning how to win. But again, coming back to consistency, how do you execute when you got so many opportunities? So all those races along there, how do you consistently execute and put yourself in the right place? We've got to have that racing mind. And some of that, I think, was from Simon's upbringing and his development, but certainly he studied in order to know what to do. It wasn't a totally innate trait. I think there's some athletes that have this a little bit more innate than others, but he was a student of the sport. He studied where to put himself. The gamification of racing and preparation. This is something I always kind of knew about Simon, but he gave me this word, gamification. And I think it's something that provided the motivation for him. He did see it sort of as a game, that preparation, or as a puzzle of how do you put together these things. And we talked about where did that race intelligence, that tactical awareness come from? But I really did see it like a game. He'd analyze performances, he studied videos, he did all the things that we think maybe in team sports is more common, but I wonder how much of that is happening in individual sports. And this was one point, that student of the sport thing, that I think is perhaps being lost for some athletes. They take it for granted. They show up for races. They eat, sleep, train, show up for races, and perhaps don't study the history, don't study the tactics, don't study even how do you prepare. What have people done before you? It's easy to sort of be in your own bubble and not realize what's going on in the world around you. But I think Simon was able to see past that. And he talked a lot about visualization, and you know, I think that came from watching videos and understanding the sport, so that when he was in those key moments, he could pull the trigger, he could execute. So I think that was really important. And Simon probably at some times had like a short attention span, which I think it kind of went into this. He was interested in a lot of different topics regarding his preparation and his racing, so he could gain energy from a lot of those things. And as I said, he thought of it as a game. So the next was Simon's self-management and environment. And though I think the psychology part was very important and made him unique, I think this element was perhaps different than many, many athletes that I see now. And the first one is a deep ownership and management of his environment around him. And I think some Canadians would observe that, certainly from a distance, but his ability, he just didn't take it for granted that this is the environment, this is my coach, these are the staff. He really influenced what that environment around him was like in an active way. And we often talk about athlete ownership and what does that mean? Engagement in your program, so you're not just doing your training, you're an active partner in that. And he influenced the coaches that are around him. I listed some of them. The staff, he had an extraordinary influence over the staff that would work around him. He was able to influence the federation to get what he needed and to mobilize resources. And training partners. We were able to attract training partners from all over Canada, all over the world. At various times in Victoria, we had athletes from all over the world that Simon would attract and we would support to build his training environment. So this intuition about what he needed in a very active way. And again, I think that's something that I've not seen very often. It was very difficult to manage. I can't say it was easy. And I'm sure there's a lot of people, certainly in Canada, that were on the outside, which would have perhaps a different impression of the impact that had on other people, but the ability for him to get what he needed, he was totally active in that process. At the same time, he was also very coachable. He's somebody that you had to get buy-in and engagement from. He didn't take it for granted, though, here's your plan, do it. Not at all. You needed to get buy-in on everything that you did. And that's typically when you'd run into trouble, is if you didn't get to buy in something. You know, you get that sense that maybe this camp or this training session you didn't really believe in, and then it would come out later. So later on, I learned, and I'm sure the others did as well, that he needed to be on board and be an active partner in all of that. And again, engagement and support staff, he would actively seek out people. Sometimes it was extremely challenging. I was looking through emails yesterday. I had emails from Hamish Carter asking about training. I had emails from Chris McCormick asking about training, from all sorts of different people, and he would gather these inputs kind of beyond the sports support staff, but looking for ideas and looking for input. And certainly within the Triathlon Canada support staff, he would actively go out and seek what he needed. Again, so not passive at all. I mean, this is maybe obvious, but the points from the video, I mean, very, very highly driven, challenging to everybody around him. And I think we know, either by example or from hearing, many of the great champions in our sport are not easy athletes to deal with. They're challenging, and I think that's a real positive. I think sometimes they get spun as, oh, these are difficult people. But I think those are what make athletes great. And we've got to figure out how to manage those kind of people, because those are where our big champions are often the traits they're going to have, where they're going to come from, are these very highly driven, relentless people. And certainly I had to learn that. I mean, through my journey with Simon, from again changing the roles from training partner to I was a coach when he, at the training center when he was with Lance, and then coming into his lead coach, I had to grow and change very, very quickly, and he challenged me to do that. And probably if he hadn't done that, I don't know if I'd be standing here. The belief and I think more importantly the enjoyment in the process. It becomes cliche, doesn't it, to talk about process, but it's the basics that still is fundamental to achieving success. You've got to engage and enjoy that process. I certainly think of some athletes that they're very much about the success they have, and when they can't have the success, their motivation drops, which of course is counterintuitive. If your motivation drops, if your drive drops, if your belief drops when you're struggling, how are you going to come through the other side of that and be successful again? And I think Simon never lost sight of that process. Of course, we often talk about, and Simon achieved, Olympic medals and big performances, but we rarely talked about that in the process. In fact, there was only one time when we talked about that. It was prior to Lausanne Worlds 2006, when I started to have this idea that it should put like a countdown to the world champs that year and countdown to the Olympics and this kind of thing. And then I later regretted that because I felt it added this external sort of pressure to the environment that was taking away from what do we need to do well today? What do we need to do well right now? And that's what that process is, and enjoying that process. I mean, endurance sport is sometimes monotonous, it's repetitive, it's a lot of work, as we saw with the presentations yesterday. I mean, it's a lot of hours, it's continuous, it's almost year-round, and it's, you know, in this case, more than a decade long of that. And you've got to enjoy that. Take it for granted, but you've got to enjoy it. Simon did have a bit of a chip on his shoulder and something to improve. And I think we, you know, this is maybe common when people talk about big champions. They have particular personalities. Many of them come from troubled upbringing. Simon didn't really. But, you know, something to prove, I think, is important. You've got, where does your motivation come? It's different for different athletes. But the thing that Simon could do is turn this into a process driver. He could bring it back to process. So he could be annoyed or upset about something, politically, federation, other athletes, but he could turn that back into, right, what do I need to do in my preparation to be better now? And whereas some athletes, they let that stuff eat away at them, and it becomes a negative. So I think being able to switch that frame of reference is really important, coming back to that process. So a little bit about preparation. Physical and mental resilience, of course, you know, probably hard to talk about consistency in a career if you didn't talk about whether the athletes had many injuries or not. And Simon was fortunate he didn't have very many injuries over his career. And a couple points down, we might talk about why that is. But it is very important, right? He didn't suffer really any major injuries that took out long periods of time that was due to training. There was a few bike crashes, that sort of thing, which you have to deal with in sport, but physically very resilient. I think that comes back to good management, good self-management. I mean, injuries ultimately are often caused by overloading, and the athlete's ability to contribute to that management, to make decisions, really important to avoiding that, but equally mentally resilient. And the story to think about in this case for both of those is prior to the Manchester Commonwealth Games in 2002, Simon was racing in Australia in Geelong. He crashed, broke both of his wrists, and I think either one or both of his collarbones, so he was out. He couldn't swim, and that would have been in March, maybe. And Commonwealth Games, Manchester, remember when it was, July, August, but not very long. And he was able to totally come back to process of what he needed to do to prepare. For a lot of athletes, there's no way they were getting to the start line and no way they were going to win as he did. But I remember the memory that I have is him being on pool deck, cast, sling, and pedaling while everyone else was swimming and doing whatever he could do to move forward that little bit. and not get down, because at that time, Commonwealth Games was a big major goal for him, and he really wanted to prepare, and so he was able to pull himself together for that. Minimal training-related injuries, as I just covered. And again, emphasizing the management of how important that was. It was somebody that, you know, for example, you know the athlete, primary principal, couldn't do a lot of track work, so we would avoid those kind of situations. Might get the only really issues that he had were some Achilles problems, but we could avoid that. So this was an interesting one that came up. Training at 80% of his maximum capacity. This is what he said. And in reflection, I went back and looked, and I thought, you know, I think there's something here. And I think through a combination of the different coaches that he had, the environments that he had, our learning together in our phase, and his influence, probably most importantly, he reflected, he thought he only really trained at 80% of the capacity that he had. So if he could train 30 hours a week, 80% of that was what he was typically doing. And sure enough, I actually looked back at that, and looked at 2007, 2008, probably the best years of his career. I couldn't count too many weeks over 25 hours of volume. And there's lots of reasons why, as Sergio said, you know, you get into racing, you're traveling, all sorts of this stuff. But he was never somebody that was successful because he was pushing a high volume. I think he was successful in part, coming back to the resilience, that he didn't put himself in a place where his body broke down, and probably equally as important, that mentally he didn't break down. And I think in 2008, that was 1 week over 25 hours. So that's on the low side of what we saw yesterday, but important to know for him as an athlete, as an individual. But I like this concept increasingly as I'm growing older as a coach of minimum effective dose. I thought earlier in my career, I thought, no, this, you know, we're trying to win. You need to do the most. But as I've gotten older, and I think it's one of the secrets of what we're doing now, if there's such a thing as a secret, is we don't actually train as much as a lot of groups. And I think that was key for Simon as well. The other thing that came up yesterday, high athleticism and motor learning. Simon was a real athlete. He could have done many, many different sports. And you could see that. Sometimes it'd get him into trouble. He'd go for a soccer game in the middle of the season, and he would end up very sore as a result. But his athleticism and ability to learn skills, very high, very rare. I don't know if I've ever come across anyone since that has the ability to learn skills. You could tell him to do something, and he would do it. Great proprioception. And I think that probably contributed, again, to the physical resilience. And the other key point, variation and change over time. You saw he had different coaches. He was able to reinvent himself. How many athletes just sort of get stuck doing one thing their whole career? Change his training, keep the mind and body fresh. Certainly, you know, if you think of that span of career, being able to do that, having the courage to do that. You know, certainly when our time finished, we come off success in Beijing, but he could recognize that he needed to make a change if he was going to evolve in the next cycle. And that's quite courageous and important. And finally, his innovative attitude. He was always interested in technology and gadgets, and we had to kind of control this, take what was important. But it goes to the point above, keeping the mind and body fresh. So for me, the takeaway that I learned is not that those things are very important, because I don't think they are, but from an interest, engagement point of view, really important, that he was able to find sources of inspiration. It could be looking what cycling teams are doing with power meters, or looking at swimming models, or what are the guys in the swimming pool doing, just learning from your environment around you. So the summary of the success factors. So certainly the self-management engagement, extraordinary. Don't come across many athletes that are capable of doing that in the way that he did, all-encompassing. The racing and preparation intelligence, extraordinary, both from a preparation, intuition, knowledge, and ability to apply that to racing. And finally, that consistent, progressive, and varied preparation through his career. So it changed. It was both consistent in loading, but it did change, and it was progressive, and he was able to adapt and grow through that. Finally, just one quick quote. This was post-Beijing, and I quite like this story. If we fund our athletes, we're innovative, we don't bow to the nattering chorus, which I think is quite a good lesson for many people in high-performance sport. Those are the outside that are chirping away at you when you're going about your business of trying to win. Talented, brave, and committing our whole self. And I think that sums up Simon, that sums up how you can be consistent at a very high level over a long period of time. Totally committing yourself, knowing that it will hurt if you fail. And of course, this just doesn't apply to Canada, but good story. So finally, yeah, I mean, Simon is, he was the flag bearer here, and he's a legend in Canadian sport. Lots to learn from Simon, so I was very happy to be able to revisit some of this stuff. And as I said at the beginning, there's a lot of stuff that I take away that doing with my work now, and I think many of the great champions like Simon have a lot to teach us, and we should come back to that. So finally, this is me. Get in touch with me. I've got a podcast, and I'm going to put some nice excerpts of Simon's interview, particularly the interesting stuff for people might be how he dealt with the emergence of the Brownlees and what he might do differently with what he knows now, so in the later stages of a career. So do get in touch, follow our work, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Joel. I think we have time for a couple of quick questions and quick answers.
Thank you for the nice presentation. One interesting question. What is he doing in order to prepare himself for life after sport? A wonderful career. What's going to be next?
For Simon, yeah? That was the question. What's Simon doing? Or all athletes, yeah? Simon's doing a lot of speaking now. He's, as you might predict, he's doing a lot of different things. It's very Simon. He's invested in different businesses. I mean, the point you raise, it's not easy to transition from being a lifelong athlete. At what point does the education and schooling you did cease to be relevant, really? But Simon is transitioned very nicely. He does a lot of speaking to businesses now. Some of the process stuff we talked about, I mean, it's very applicable to in a wide range of fields. So that's what he's doing now. A lot of different things, but a lot of speaking.
Thank you for your presentation. You've covered some psychological traits from Simon. How big do you consider your own contribution to these traits, and how would you develop or foster them?
My contribution to Simon's traits. I think my role at the time in his career was perhaps more about managing some of those traits. The interest that we talk about, that I was talking about, interested in a lot of different things. I kind of saw my role as bringing the focus back. And I think that's been a key for Simon, but for any athlete, is particularly in the modern sporting context of there are so many things that can become so complicated, and I think the role of the coach is often filtering what is actually important, because you cannot do everything all the time. You have to make decisions, and certainly that was key with Simon, is he would become interested in something. Hey, what about this new saddle? Should I put this on right now? No. Might be a good idea, but let's maybe do this in the off season, for example. That kind of thing. Managing, simplifying, and keeping focused.
Thank you.
Okay, we have to finish now. Thank you. Please join me at thanking Joel Fillol.